disciples. And before you run me off, and before you get up and run out, I know, first you have to be saved to be a disciple. But just because you're a believer doesn't automatically make you a disciple. Because in Matthew it says, Jesus actually describes what a disciple should look like. It says the disciple is not above his master, nor the servant above his Lord. It is enough for the disciple to be as his master and the servant as his Lord. The word disciple literally means student or learner. And Vine's Dictionary of New Testament Words describes it as one who follows another's teachings. Yes. The word disciple implies not only being a disciple, but discipline. Right?
Amen.
It's not only are you a student or a learner, but you're one who follows or adheres to what you're being taught.
Yes.
That's why in the early church the disciples were called Christians. That literally meant imitators of Christ. To be a disciple is to strive to be more and more like Christ. Do we always do that? Do we, every day, do we strive to be more and more Christ-like? I heard a sermon one time, outstanding sermon, that said, to know the will of God, you've got to have the mind of Christ.
Uh-huh.
And that's true.
Right.
We should daily strive to be more and more Christ-like. In Romans 8:29, Paul said, God's goal for redeeming and saving mankind were that they would be more conformed to the image of His Son. When we look at the early Christians, we consider kind of radical their form of Christianity. But when they look at us, they see us as having a watered-down form of Christianity. Now I ask you, are you striving to be a learner and a student of Christ? Are you striving to be like Him? If not, I ask you this, are you a true disciple? How can we fulfill that great commission if we don't have a clear understanding of what a disciple is? According to God's Word, the disciples have certain characteristics. In John it says, then Jesus said to the Jews who believed Him, if you abide in My Word, you are My disciple. A disciple is one who abides in Christ's Word. According to Strong's Dictionary of Greek and Hebrew Words, the word here for abide means to stay. It also can be used as continue, to dwell, to endure, to be present, to remain, to stand, not to tarry. If someone speaks to you and ask you, are you a disciple? Can you honestly say, yes, I am? Because they're asking you, when they ask you if you're a disciple, they're asking you if you abide in the Word of the Lord.
Yes.
Are you talking the talk or are you walking the walk?
Amen.
That's the question today. A disciple abides in God's Word. It's also someone who studies God's Word and applies it to their life. Do we apply it to our lives like we should? And some of us, yeah, I do. No, we don't. No, we don't. But that should be what we strive for every day. Also, John said, as a new commandment I give you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you may also love one another. By this, all will know you are my disciple if you have loved one another. Amen? A disciple is someone who loves others with the type of love that Jesus showed us, because it says, as I have loved you. And secondly, with a love that is visible, because it says, by this all will know. Now we got to realize a disciple is someone who wants to become like the teacher.
Yes.
Jesus was willing to sacrifice the time and effort to His fellow believers. Do we do that? Do we sacrifice the time and whatever it takes to try to disciple someone? Do we do that? Do we walk the walk, or do we just talk the talk? says a disciple is one who bears much fruit. In John 15 it says, by this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, so that you will be my disciple. If you notice, it says much fruit. It doesn't say, do you bear a little fruit? Do you bear fruit just every once in a while? It says, do you bear much fruit?
Yes.
Jesus isn't talking about an occasional good deed here. He's talking about a lifestyle which causes people to glorify God. Are you living a life pleasing to God today?
Amen.
Are you living a life that brings attention and glory to God? Or are you living a life according to your own desires, your own pleasures? Are you living your life in a way that brings all the glory to you or to God? Matthew 5 says, let your light shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. It does not say, let your light shine before men and then they may see your good works and glorify you.
Amen.
Right. It says that you may glorify your Father which is in heaven.
Amen.
Are you living a life that brings glory to God? When someone notices your good works, do you take all the credit or do you let God have the credit? In John 15 it says this, the vine that doesn't bear fruit is taken away. Now I've heard different teachings on this. Some say it's about losing their salvation. Others say it refers to someone that's never been saved. I'm not sure. I'm not going to argue that. I'm going to let you study the Scriptures and pray and let God speak to you about what this means. But either way, you can't be a disciple if you're taken away.
Right.
Are you bearing much fruit for God? A disciple requires total commitment, especially in regards to the teachings of Christ, the love for other believers, bearing fruit to the glory of God. But we got to look a little further. We got to consider the cost of being a disciple. Jesus talks about the cost of fellowship in Luke 14. He says, if any man come to me and hate not his father and his mother and his wife and his children and his brother and sister and his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Now, I don't believe that Jesus is here showing us that we've got to hate our family members and our friends and ourselves. Instead, I believe what he was doing is using a sharp contrast here to make a point, or hyperbole for another word. In Matthew, he addresses the same thought. Jesus says, do not think I've come to bring peace on earth, for I've come to set man against father, a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. Being a disciple, Jesus is saying, will cause conflict in your personal life. It may cause you to have conflict with your family or with your friends. Are you willing to risk that conflict to become a disciple of Christ? Luke 9 says, a disciple must be willing to suffer and even die for Christ. By trying to live godly lives in an ungodly world, we suffer ridicule and we suffer persecution. And as a matter of fact, I can almost guarantee you, if you do not stand out in this world, you're probably fitting in a little too well.
Amen?
Amen.
Amen?
Yes.
The Bible says to be in the world, not of the world.
Amen.
To be a disciple, Jesus must not only be our Savior, but He also must be the Lord of our lives every day.
Yeah.
A lot of us say, yes, Jesus, we want you to be our Savior. But how many of us say, yes, Jesus, we want you to be the Lord of our life every day? He's saying, I want to be in total control of your life. To reign over every area in your life that you have. You don't just give me a little piece of it. You don't give me the part when you're in trouble, the part when you're in grief. You don't just give me those parts. I want your whole life.
Yes.
I want every part of it. Luke says, whoever does not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. I'm telling you, today a lot of churches and a lot of the self-help gurus and everybody tell you that your problems can all be solved if you just build up your self-esteem. But Paul says something very different. Because it sounds to me like Paul's got a very low self-esteem because he says, oh, wretched man that I am.
Yes.
In Timothy it says, in the last day, people will become lovers of self.
Yes.
And if you look around, that's exactly what we've got.
Yes.
And this cost of discipleship has caused so many people to turn away from following Christ. But see, Christ wasn't trying to attract the huge crowds. He did, but he wasn't trying to. Because he wasn't trying to attract the half-hearted, the lukewarm people of his time. You could say that Jesus wanted quality more than he wanted quantity.
Yeah.
I heard a story one time about a man that got lost in the desert. He was wandering around for a long time and he became very thirsty, very dry, and he saw a little shack in the desert. He made his way over to this shack and found a water pump with a small jug of water and a note on it. Now you guys don't know what I'm talking about, anybody that's ever primed a pump. The note said, pour all the water in the top of the pump to prime it. And if you do this, you will have all the water you will need. Now the man had a choice to make. If he trusted the note and poured in all the water, and it worked, he'd have all the water he needed. If it didn't work, he'd be thirsty and die. Or he could choose to drink the water in the jug and get immediate satisfaction. But it might not be enough. He still might die. After thinking about it, the man decided to take the risk. He poured the entire jug into the pump and began to work the handle. And at first nothing came out. He got a little scared, so he pumped faster. And all of a sudden, water started gushing out. He had so much water that he drank all he could drink. He took a bath in it. He filled every container he could find because he was willing to give up momentary satisfaction.
Yes.
Because he was willing to do this, he got all the water he needed. Now the note also said, after you finish, please refill the jug next to the next thirsty traveler. The man refilled the jug and he added the note. Please prime the pump. Believe me, it works. We've got the same choice to make. Do we hold on to what we have because we don't believe there are better things in store for us? Do we settle for the immediate satisfaction that we get? Or do we trust in God, give up everything we've got, and get what God promised us? I think the choice is obvious. We need to pour in all the water.
Yeah.
Relationship with Christ. Because he's the object of our discipleship. And you say, yeah, Brett, that's obvious. But some people it may not be. Because I'm not talking about just saying I believe in God and Jesus and all that stuff. I'm talking about a love, a heartfelt relationship with the Creator of the universe. Has Christ taken residence in your heart? Have you ever asked Him to be your one and only Savior? But also, have you ever asked Him to be the Lord, to rule and reign over every area of your life? Because only when you do this can He conform you to be the all He wants you to be. And you can't do this in your own strength. Only He can do it, and only if we allow Him to.
Amen?
I'll get off on a rabbit hole here for a minute. When I was in jail, and I asked the Lord into my life, I was asking Him into my life to get me out of jail. You know, it was one of these things, okay, Lord, I believe in You now. You made a believer out of me, now just shake these cell doors open. But it wasn't until He worked on my heart that I finally said, Lord, I give it all to You.
Yes.
Not just me being in here. I don't care if You get me out of here, Lord. I'm giving You my life because there's nothing in that stinking past that I want to go back to.
Amen.
I'm done with it.
Amen.
I'm done with it.
Yes.
And when I did that, the Lord blessed me.
Yes.
The Lord blessed me in so many ways. I could stand up here, and if we didn't have a baptism, I'd be going until we had the singing benefit tonight at 5 o'clock, but I'm not going to do that to you guys.
Amen.
Amen.
Give it all up.
Yes.
If you haven't gave it all up yet, give it all up to God.
Yes.
Paul says, present your body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service or your act of worship, whatever your translation you read.
Yes.
Paul's talking more about just acknowledging that Jesus is God. He's talking about obedience. He's talking about sacrifice. Oh, my God. I know. You say, oh, no, I wish He hadn't went there. I wish He hadn't went there. He says, you know what He says? He says, deny yourself and take up your cross daily and follow Christ. What's He talking about? Taking up your cross is making God's will your will. You lay aside all your personal goals and desires and ambition, and that's when God will reveal the desires, goals, and ambitions that He has for you. You got to submit your goals. You got to give up your ambitions. You got to go with God's. Have you done that? Are you following Christ? Are you still the Lord of your own life? We also got to be students of the Bible, Brother Carey.
We gotta
read it regularly. We gotta allow Him to speak to our hearts through the Bible. I would encourage you to study God's Word daily and pray and ask Him to speak to you through what you read. And then, are you obedient to what we know to do? Because knowing what to do is not good enough. Just knowing what to do is not good enough.
That's right.
We can't just talk the talk. Like I said earlier, we got to walk the walk. It's been said that faith turned said faith into real faith. Think about that. If you're aware of God's will for your life, but you're unwilling to follow, then you are not a disciple.
Amen?
Are you looking for God's will in your life? And when you know it, are you willing to follow it? Then comes baptism. That's what we're doing today. Praise God. Thank You, Jesus. Amen. Matthew says, in Matthew 28, the verse starts with saying, make disciples. It says, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
Let me say something right now. Starting being baptized, it doesn't change nothing when you're standing before Christ. Baptizing, Baptism is an outward sign of an inward change.
Yes.
It's symbolic of being born again. The old man's dead, buried, and the new man is born.
Amen.
Yes. In Acts 10, it says the Holy Ghost fell on them, and they were baptized. Baptism is an act of submission. We first put our faith in Christ, and then we repent of our sins, and then we're baptized. Galatians says, for many of you have been baptized into Christ, have put on Christ. The Bible puts a great influence on a spiritual baptism and on a physical baptism.
Yes.
Have you been baptized into Christ, both physically and spiritually? If not, I encourage you to do so.